Park Row Books and Harper Audio present Old Fashioned on Purpose, Cultivating a Slower, More Joyful Life by Jill Winger. Read by Jill Winger and Andrew Eiden. This is the author. A note before we begin. Don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider. It contains some of my favorite recipes, additional resources, and more, and will be referred to throughout as the enhancement.
Foreword by Rory Feek. I've known Jill Winger for a few years now. First, I knew her as the writer of a popular homesteading blog that my wife and I visited often for tips on gardening and cooking. Then a few years later, she appeared out of thin air in our kitchen, or at least her face did, on the cover of the Prairie Homestead cookbook, as she guided us through many wonderful home-cooked recipes and meals. Finally, in the fall of 2019, we met in person at a homesteading conference in Virginia. I listened to her talk in front of thousands of folks who'd traveled from all over the country to learn skills and wisdom that have sadly stopped being passed down generationally, and I walked away inspired. Over the next couple of years, I visited the Winger's home a few times on our way to and from Montana. Why she and her husband Christian would pick what seems to be the absolute hardest place to homestead in the country, I'm not sure, but my guess is, like most of us, they decided they had found a home and made a go of it. And season by season, year by year, she and her family have coaxed not only vegetables, pasture-raised beef, and an amazing life from the ground they live on, but they've done it publicly, always with a hand stretched out, helping and encouraging others on their homesteading journey. Eventually, she would make trips to our farm and speak at events that we hosted here. And I've been so blessed not only to get to know Jill and her family on a deeper level, but also to learn much about what comprises the book you are holding in your hands. This past fall, Jill called and asked if I would write the foreword for Old Fashioned on Purpose. I told her I'd be honored to. And a few weeks later, her manuscript came in the mail, 225 pages printed on white paper for me to read the old-fashioned way, which was perfect, because I was personally in the middle of a year-long hiatus from the web. As I now move into the 8th month of my internet-free year, I have just finished reading the manuscript. From the first page to the last, this book she's written reminds me why I'm taking the break that I'm taking. Not only that, but it challenges me to consider digging even deeper into the good life that I've discovered the last dozen or so years here at our farm. This book is filled with wisdom and truth from cover to cover. Jill has the spirit and work ethic of a pioneer, but the patience and heart of a teacher. Her passion to do the hard things that make our lives better and to help others do the same fills every page. Old Fashioned on Purpose is for the homesteader in all of us. Whether you are a newcomer, just now discovering the joy of sowing seeds in the soil and baking your first loaf of sourdough bread, or have been at it a while and are questioning everything that the world has told and sold us for the last few decades, you are on the path of reclaiming your precious time and attention. This book also resonated deeply with me on a personal level. Now in my late 50s, I am constantly looking back to see what I can glean from those who came before me. I yearn to seek wisdom from days and people of old who, though they had lived through times much harder than our own, seemed to have more fulfilling lives. From part one, where Jill makes her case for why we need to consider being old-fashioned on purpose, to part two, where she breaks it down and shows us how to do just that, the information in this book is life-changing. Jill reminds readers that in all of us, no matter where we are in life or in the world, is the power to grow, to cook, to work, to unplug, and to find community. Following this is the peace that comes from striving for something more than more. Filled with how-tos and, just as importantly, why-tos, old-fashioned on purpose is a life spring of health and hope in a time when what we need most doesn't begin with Insta or Face, but instead begins with us. It begins with the garden, the kitchen, and the table, and with getting our families to slow down and sit for a while. It begins with not just eating the bounty that God has provided for us, but also knowing that we have taken part in the process ourselves. It's easy to see that our lives are clearly much easier today than they were 100 or so years ago, but I don't believe that they are better. Like Jill, I am unabashedly old-fashioned on purpose, and it has made my life all the richer. This book has given me much to think about and much to put into practice as I step into the new frontier. Rory Feek.
Introduction. There's something rippling through humanity right now. It's not a trend, but a craving, a longing, a remembering, a sense that we are more capable than we've been led to believe, a whisper that there could be another path, one that's less traveled but brimming with possibilities that make us feel awake, not sedated. It's not the first time this stirring has visited us. It appears whenever society threatens to lose its moorings, whenever we become so whipped into a frenzy by fear, panic, or turmoil that we lose our way. This still, small voice taps us on the shoulder and prompts us to pause, to return to the things that matter, to ground ourselves in the rhythms of the earth, to remember from whence we came. It appeared during the Great Depression as financial chaos pushed thousands to the country. It occurred in the 1970s when societal unrest and the Vietnam War spurred the Back to the Land movement. And it's happening again at this very moment. I started feeling these tugs as a little girl, but I didn't know what to do with them. After all, the old-fashioned notions that visited my imagination weren't rational. They weren't accepted. And they certainly weren't normal. But 14 years ago, I finally heeded their call. As a result, I now live a peculiar hybrid life. On one hand, I'm probably not much different than any other modern mom of three. A robot vacuums my floors, my online business relies on high-tech apps and software, and I listen to audiobooks while I drive my kids to basketball practice. Yet, I also dig potatoes for supper from my backyard. My basement is lined with jars of food I've grown and canned myself. I capture wild yeast, ferment cabbage on my kitchen counters, cure hams, and render lard for pie crusts. I also know how to butcher a chicken, ride a horse, tamp a fence post, build a fire, and create my own soap. These old-fashioned parts of my life would hardly have been worth mentioning a century ago. But in the age of virtual reality, cryptocurrencies, and Uber Eats, they seem wild and revolutionary. I didn't grow up practicing most of these retro skills, but they're second nature to me now. The thought of an existence without farm animals, barn chores, and ever-present kitchen projects rarely crosses my mind. Each year, I take stock of our life and ask myself, should we continue? Do these vintage ways still serve us? Are these pursuits worth the extra time they take? And each year, the answer is a resounding yes, but not for the most obvious reasons. Sure, I love the taste of crisp garden veggies, the scent of freshly cut hay, the sound of roosters in the morning, and the sight of my kids running through the barnyard. But that's not why I continue. Rather, I persevere in these heritage skills because they're much more than the sum of their parts. I forge ahead for the rewards that stretch beyond what I can taste, touch, and see. This lifestyle grounds me when the world feels like a whirlwind. It offers meditation during chaos, a healthy dose of adventure, and a quiet confidence born from trusting your abilities. These time-honored practices remind me of what truly matters, and I reach for them whenever I'm craving balance and solace. Over the decades, this idea of returning to the land and our roots has been given a variety of titles, but I've never loved any of them. I've used the term homesteading for years, but believe it or not, it gets muddied by the idea that participants can still find free land. The Homestead Act was repealed in 1976. Or that a modern homesteader must live off-grid or own hundreds of acres. None of these assumptions are true. It's time for a better definition. For me, this is a mindset. It's about stripping away the baggage of our modern lives, recognizing the problems of progress, moving through this world with intention, resisting rampant consumerism, living lightly and consciously, and being rooted in community. If I could give everyone 5 acres and a milk cow, I would. But that's not possible. And honestly, it's not even necessary. This is a mentality that anyone can adopt, no matter where they live. It has absolutely nothing to do with how much land you own or what types of farm animals you keep. So, what should we call it? I like the term old-fashioned on purpose for several reasons. To me, old-fashioned doesn't mean out of date or out of touch. Rather, it's a clue that something of value is just under the surface waiting to be discovered. Our family and others like us aren't old-fashioned because we don't know any better, or because it's our only option, or because we resist change, or because a particular social or religious circle has conditioned us to avoid mainstream culture. Instead, this is a conscious choice we've made to reclaim meaningful ideas that have been discarded in the name of progress and restore them to a place of value in our modern day-to-day. This process will look radically different depending on each person's situation. But regardless of how you make this shift, it has the potential to change your life just like it has mine. The homestead remains my greatest teacher. The epiphanies it's granted me continue to shape every part of my perspective. Throughout the following pages, I'll distill down the most impactful lessons I've gleaned so you can make them your own. In part one, we'll dissect the past to discover how we got off track as a culture and find clues to help us move forward. In part two, we'll weave the past with the present by identifying the 8 principles of the old-fashioned on-purpose lifestyle that you can adopt no matter where you live. We'll dive into the how of growing your own ingredients, cooking from scratch, working with your hands, stepping away from the synthetic, unplugging from technology, caring for the earth, fostering independence in our children, and cultivating community. But more importantly, we'll discuss the why. While the technical aspect of these skills are important, it's this deeper intention that will sustain you when challenges arise. The why transforms these quaint practices into life-changing propositions. And that's when the magic truly begins. So if you've felt curious about how things used to be, disenchanted with the complexities of modern life, or just strangely drawn to sourdough bread, you're in exactly the right place. Part 1. The case for old-fashioned on purpose. Chapter 1. You're not alone. Sometimes I think of myself as a reverse pioneer. Like the original pioneers, I'm headed into the unknown. But while they trekked west in search of opportunities that would usher in the future, I'm going the opposite direction, back to the past. Like most pioneers, I was met with skepticism when I started my journey. Initially, I didn't know a soul who shared my fascination for churning butter and growing tomatoes. I learned to smile and ignore the comments. "You're making homemade yogurt? Is that even safe?" "Be careful. Canning gives you food poisoning." "They sell all of that at the store, you know." People weren't trying to be negative. They simply couldn't fathom why I'd go to all the trouble of reviving these outdated practices. To be fair, I didn't fully grasp the enormity of what I was doing either. I just knew the gardens and kitchen kept calling to me, so I kept listening. Those early years were exhilarating, yet lonely. But times have changed. Over the past few years, backyard chicken coops have become a status symbol of sorts. Real estate listings boast the homesteading potential of various properties, farm-to-fork restaurants are considered fine dining, and consumers are attracted to anything labeled farm fresh or farmhouse chic. Somehow, I've gone from being the lone pioneer on the fringe to sitting on the front lines of a movement. My inboxes are filled to the brim with people asking for help with their milk cows and compost and garden planning. It's amazing and shocking. But it's not hard to figure out why all things farm are experiencing a renaissance, especially right now. Even in a world run by mind-boggling technology.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.